blessing and honor to be here and to be a part of CFI and what they do. And Rick and I go back about 15 years just after we came. We started going to Sukkot Hillel, and it's been a real joy to be with Rick and Patty and see what they're doing. One of the things that is happening is just exactly what Rick has been telling you about in the last hour, is this phenomenon of prayer that's being birthed here in Jerusalem and throughout the Middle East. And it's really one of the, I think, significant movements of our time. You may not see it on CNN all the time. Hopefully you'll see it on CBN. But it's something that I think is being recorded in heaven. And when the end times, I think, are going to be recorded, that's going to be a significant part of what's happening in this part of the world. I'm going to be speaking this morning about what's happening in the Middle East, and especially as it relates to Christian persecution. And first of all, let me pray. Father, I just thank you for this time. And Lord, I want to commit it to you and ask for your anointing on myself and upon each and every one of us here in this room and those that are going to be watching this video or listening to this audio. We just pray for your anointing upon this, that we could take what's shared in here and turn it into action, whether it's praying or giving or whatever action you have called us to, Lord. We ask for that in Jesus' name. What I want to talk to you about is, and I'm going to show you a lot of videos, stories that we've done here in the Middle East about what's happening with ISIS, what's happening with a lot of the Christians that have been, really had their lives turned upside down. And just to follow up on what Rick said, in this book called Destination Jerusalem I just wrote, on page 169 it says that this theme about Jerusalem being sort of the centerpiece. It says, our true war is aimed at the liberation of Jerusalem. The army of Muhammad has begun its returning. That was a Hamas spokesperson after last summer's war with Israel. That theme resonates across the spectrum of radical Islam and its latest incarnation, ISIS, hundreds of miles east of Gaza. The flags of ISIS, blazoned with the Islamic creed, share the same objective as the Islamic brothers on the shores of the Mediterranean. When ISIS wiped the Sykes-Picot boundary off the sands of Syria and Iraq, Chilean-born Abu Safiya boasted in an ISIS video, exactly what Rick shared, that this was their first, not last, border. This is not the last border we will break. Allah will break all barriers, Iraq, Jordan, Lebanon, all of them, until we reach Jerusalem. This is the first of many barriers we will break. A website, the Black Flags of Khorasan, explained that an army will arise from the land of Khorasan, which is around Afghanistan, holding the black flags of Islam in the end times. They want to reach the next generation to, quote, create awareness among Muslim youth about an army that will rise from the area of Khorasan, Central Asia, or Afghanistan, holding black flags of Islam. This army will conquer many occupied lands of Muslims till it reaches Jerusalem. Then it will pledge its allegiance to Imam al-Mahdi, which is their Islamic Messiah. Last year, just about a year ago, it's June 3rd right now, on June 10th, ISIS took over Mosul, which is ancient Nineveh, where the prophet Jonah preached his reluctant message of repentance more than 2,000, almost 3,000 years ago. So we went there in June, then we went again in August, and we had the privilege of meeting and interviewing many of the Christians that were persecuted, some of the Yazidis that faced horrors on Mount Sinjar. We interviewed some of the Peshmerga, those that are fighting ISIS right now on the ground. Those are the boots on the ground. And when I had those experiences, and sandwiched in between that was covering the Gaza war with Hamas and Israel, I wrote a book called Destination Jerusalem, ISIS, Convert or Die, Christian Persecution and Preparing for the Days Ahead. And the reason I did that were three reasons. First of all, I wanted to tell people about ISIS and warn about the dangers of radical Islam. We'll show in a video in just a few moments about a man named Shah Alan, who was an Iraqi soldier who worked in intelligence. And during his interrogation of many of the ISIS prisoners, he found that their real goal was not just Iraq and Syria, but eventually they want to go to Europe, and eventually they have a motivation to dominate the whole world. And the second reason was that I wanted to tell believers about what's happening to their brothers and sisters in the Middle East, especially in the United States and the West, and literally all over the world. Wherever you are, it's important for you to realize what's happening to your brothers and sisters here in the Middle East. And the third reason I wanted to write the book was to help people prepare for the days ahead. We live in dark, dangerous days right now. If I could describe these days, I would cite two authors. One was Charles Dickens, and in the book, The Tale of Two Cities, he said, it was the best of times, it was the worst of times. And I think that we're going to see great light and great darkness. And that's what Isaiah said in chapter 60. He said, arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord has risen upon you, and deep darkness the peoples. And I think increasingly we're going to see a demarcation between great light and great darkness. We see great light in the prayer movements that are happening throughout the Middle East. We see great light with Muslims coming to faith with dreams or visions throughout the Islamic world. There's more Muslims coming to faith in Jesus now than in any other time in the 1,400-year history of Islam. So the great things are happening. There'll be a great harvest of souls during this time. But we also see great darkness with groups like ISIS that continue to rampage throughout the Middle East. And we see right now that they continue to advance. Ironically and sometimes tragically, the themes that I talked about in this book, Destination Jerusalem, are still viable today, even months after we wrote this. ISIS has just taken over Ramadi in Iraq. They took over a town called Palmyra in Syria. They're threatening the Golan Heights with some of those areas up there. And so Islam is on the march. And so that's also a period of great darkness. And so what I want to do right now in the time that we have, I want to show you a number of stories that we've done on what's happening in Iraq, in northern Iraq. And the first story is going to be a little further beyond that. It was back in August of 2013. But this sort of sets the stage of what's happening to many believers. We went down to Minya, Egypt, which is in Upper Egypt, and at that time, just to give you a context for the story, there had been a great overthrow of Mohammed Morsi, who was a Muslim Brotherhood president at the time. There was a huge outcry by the population. Over 30 million people went to the streets to protest his government. It was the largest political demonstration in history. It overthrew the government. Well, part of the coalition that overthrew Mohammed Morsi was the Christian Church, the Coptic Church, as many other churches. The Muslim Brotherhood reacted by burning and looting dozens of churches in Minya and throughout Egypt. And we went down there to cover what happened to them. And this is our first story, David, down in Minya, Egypt. The city of Minya sits at the epicenter of the persecution against the Christian church. This is the Emir Tadros Church in Minya, just one of the dozens of churches that have been destroyed throughout Egypt. This is a 100-year-old church, and as you can see, it's been completely destroyed on the inside. One Egyptian expert said the violence against the churches in Egypt is the worst in nearly 700 years. This exclusive video, aired for the first time on nationwide TV, shows the inside of the sanctuary is completely gutted and the altar destroyed. Now the church uses this makeshift altar outside, and the pastor explained to us they started holding their services at 6:30 in the morning. Engineers say the church would need to be torn down before it could be rebuilt.
To be sure that everything is burned, they put fire in every place. Before this time, they make a sign for Christian places or cars or houses or buildings, and if the place has an X on it, they burn the place.
The churches weren't the only targets. Schools, cars, and businesses owned by Christians were destroyed. Muslim radicals marked Christian businesses with a black X before torching them. Perhaps most shocking was the destruction of this Christian orphanage. This is a Coptic Christian orphanage called Christ Soldiers. Muslim mobs came in here and they destroyed the building, leaving about 200 children without shelter. But they wanted to leave a message for the attackers, and they wrote it on the wall outside. And it said, you meant to hurt us, but we forgive you. God is love. Everything works out for good. They also wrote, love your enemies. Evangelical ministries bore the brunt of many attacks. This is what remains of the bookstore in Minya of the Bible Society of Egypt. Their store in nearby Eshut was also destroyed. Those bookstores used to look like this one, the Bible Society's main bookstore in Cairo. Now the Bibles, Christian books, and children's materials are in shambles.
For the last 130 years, we have been operating. We have bookshops in the streets, in main cities, in Cairo, Alexandria, Tanta, Upper Egypt, and it has never happened in the history of the Bible Society.
According to this Egyptian website, more than 60 churches were attacked from Minya, Alexandria, Giza, Suez, and throughout Egypt.
The rampage began after Muslim Brotherhood supporters used the churches as scapegoats for the army's decision to break up two Brotherhood protest camps in Cairo. They also blamed the church for participating in the ouster of President Mohamed Morsi. Yet Christians point out many of their Muslim neighbors defended and protected them. They don't see this as a Muslim against Christian issue, but as the Muslim Brotherhood against the Christians. And even though they have been targeted, they are responding with forgiveness and pressing on in the face of persecution. This Sunday school class at the Amir Tadros Church now meets in an alcove off the main building. They're learning about the namesake of the church, who was a Christian martyr. It's not your typical Sunday school lesson.
These days, I think the children have a life experience. They see their church burned. They see how us forgive our enemies.
We respond as every other Christian has responded in Egypt. We are in Egypt to serve. We are in Egypt to...
The city of Minya sits...
What really struck me in that being down in Minya was two things. First of all, what they wrote outside the Christian orphanage, Soldiers of Christ, that they would forgive those that meant to do them harm, and that God was love, and to forgive your enemies. And the other thing was that Sunday school lesson at the Samuel Tadros Church. They had been attacked, their church had been burned, and yet they were teaching the next generation to forgive and what maybe they have to do to suffer for their faith and the price they have to pay. And that's what many of brothers and sisters right now are paying, sometimes the ultimate price, throughout the Middle East. The next story is about the Iraqi refugee camp that we went to almost just less than a year ago, right after ISIS had taken over Mosul, and here's this story. The stunning blitzkrieg by ISIS left thousands of broken lives in its wake. This is one of the many refugee camps set up in the region. This one is just a few days old. And literally within the region, hundreds of thousands of people have been displaced. This camp is about a 15-minute drive from the ISIS forces. And most of the people here are from the city of Nineveh. And many of the men and women, boys and girls, have seen the worst of the fighting.
I saw people without hats on the street. And people who have been killed in the streets. I saw this with my own eyes. When they got into Nineveh, they entered the houses and killed whole families. They don't care about the ages or the humanity. They only care about themselves.
That carnage drove these people away. Many refused to be interviewed by us on camera because, believe it or not, many expect to go back. Others, even some young teenage girls, told us ISIS would kill them if they returned. Now they have to adjust to another life.
In the region, according to the government, they said there was 100,000 coming to Erbil and 500,000 IDPs across the country. But now this is a really serious crisis and a challenge for the whole Iraq. So we, international organization, are here to support everyone who are in this crisis.
Camp life reduces life to basics. People need water. They clamor for ice. Kids cool off in the 100-degree heat. People fight boredom. Yet they did survive the butchery of ISIS. Sha'alan served in Iraqi intelligence and interviewed captured ISIS soldiers. He found out they have a larger agenda than Iraq.
We know that ISIS is not dreaming just to rule over Iraq, but they are dreaming to go to Europe and rule over all of the European continent. ISIS is dreaming to rule over the whole world.
The agenda of ISIS and this refugee camp are just two signs. Iraq and the Middle East may never be the same, and like Humpty Dumpty, may never be put together again. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, on the border between ISIS and Kurdish Iraq.
I think it's pretty clear that really the Middle East will never quite be the same again. What's happened in the last 5 years or so is really a historic change in what's happening. And Syria will never sort of be what we knew as Syria for decades, the same thing with Iraq. And so we're seeing a historic change in the Middle East, and lives are being caught in the middle, like those refugees. If you can imagine what it's like in your home, that you're living there for years or decades, your neighbors, you know they your neighbors, and then all of a sudden ISIS comes in and your life is turned upside down. You're living in a refugee camp. That happens to many of these refugees, and it's happening to Muslims as well as Christians. But the next story, we talk about many of the Christians. David, we can skip three and go to four, but just before that, I just wanted to explain that many of these Christians were given four choices. The first choice they had was they could leave their homes that they could have lived in for years, generations. If they chose not to leave, they could stay, but they had to pay what's called the jizya tax for infidels or non-Muslims. They could do that. Or if they wanted to stay and pay the tax, they could become a Muslim. That was their third choice. They could convert to become a Muslim. And if they chose neither of those three choices, they could die by the sword. So they had four choices, and you can imagine what that meant for many of these Christians. And this is a story we did in Erbil, which is the capital of Kurdistan, and many of these Christians had just fled ISIS and, as I said, turned their world upside down. So, David, if we could do number four.
Over this past week, the army of ISIS swallowed up parts of Iraq like a darkness.
In just one day, tens of thousands of Christians fled villages like Karakush and Bartila, just about 25 miles away. Most have come here to Erbil with nothing more than the clothes on their back.
They take everything from the house, from the store, everything. And they take like machine, everything, because they are Christian. Just the name Christian. They hate Christian especially. We don't know why.
It was leave or die.
They say if anyone don't become like Muslim, we're gonna kill it. Kill it. Each one. From baby and the woman, one, old man.
We don't have anything here. They bombed the churches and already took our houses. We have nothing here. No money, no ID, no travel documents.
What's happening now to the Christians, to the Yazidis, to the minorities, and like in the last couple of days, mostly to the Christians, is it's a genocide. What's happening is what happened 200 years ago with the Jews.
Dr. Ahmed hears stories of the barbarism of ISIS.
That ISIS was killing, shooting the kids and the people, and they are laying them on the ground, and they bring tractors that they walk over them in the front of their families. They take women out of their houses. So let's say every each family that they have three daughters, they would take one.
In the wake of the ISIS advance, thousands of ethnic Yazidis escaped to a mountain outside the town of Sinjar, while these Christians found shelter at this Catholic compound in Erbil. A few weeks ago, these families fled when ISIS cleansed Mosul of Christians. ISIS gave them an ultimatum.
They gave us four choices, either convert to Islam, or paying tax, or leaving the city, or the sword. They are using the sword to cut off hand and also beheading others. So I don't think this is the behavior of human beings, but wild animals do that.
ISIS looted their properties and left them destitute. They took this woman's dentures, wedding ring, and documents.
They took everything. We asked them, please give us something to show that we owned our car, our home. They said, here you have nothing.
ISIS searched the home of one Christian in Mosul and discovered these two New Testaments, one with a camouflage on the cover and the other with an American flag inside. They accused him of being both a missionary and a spy.
ISIS put his name on a list. He told his story, but asked us to hide his identity.
Hey, stop, get back. You are a Christian. The terrorist told me we will kill you.
Sometimes the pressure is overwhelming.
Jesus, save me. Oh, the terrorist. Forgive them. Forgive them. Because they didn't know. They didn't know what they were, what they act.
Even though these Christians are the original people of the region, many simply want to leave. They're pleading for the U.S., the UN, and Pope Francis to help.
We are asking the responsible states of the international community to come and look and see how all the people are living here.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Erbil, Kurdistan.
Video is, his name is Fadi. He had two New Testaments, and one you saw was the camouflage New Testament. He actually, after our interview, gave me that one, and I've kept it as a reminder. For those that are praying, those intercessors, please pray. I was looking for it this morning. I couldn't find it to show it to you. But I keep it, have kept it as a reminder of the many Fadis, the thousands of Fadis who have lost nearly everything. Also, one of the ladies, when we did those interviews in the Catholic compound, she came up to me and she gave me a piece of candy. And I realized there was probably one of the few things she could do to offer any form or sign of hospitality. And so I've kept both of those as just sort of a reminder of the thousands of Fadis and the thousands of women like that right now who are just living without the kind of life they used to have. I just found out this morning we had a missionary from Beirut with us, and he was saying he heard from on a WhatsApp message just this morning that another wave of Christians are leaving Baghdad and on their way to Kurdistan, which is a somewhat of a refuge. And ironically, many of the Christians that got caught in Mosul by ISIS had fled Baghdad because of all the persecution going on by Al-Qaeda for years. And so they fled to Mosul and ended up really in the crosshairs of ISIS. And also what's happening in the Middle East right now, you could describe it in the phrase, first the Saturday people, then the Sunday people. Historically, after the formation of the State of Israel in 1948, there were maybe nearly a million Jews throughout many of the Arab nations here in the Middle East. Over the next 15 years or so, from 1948, most of those Jews fled because of persecution, because of seizing their property, taking their wealth, and fled. Many of them came here to Israel. So now a similar phenomenon is happening with Christians in the region. In Iraq, there used to be about 1.4 million Christians. Now there may be 250,000. And so many of them have either fled the region, they've fled from one country to another, they've immigrated to countries like the United States, Canada, Australia, just to find another life from what they're experiencing here in the Middle East. And one thing that I've noticed, and one thing that I feels really on my heart is to share about what's happening with them. Corinthians says that if one member of the body suffers, we all suffer. And I've had two Jewish men independently, they asked me, why aren't the Christians speaking out more? And I didn't have an answer. I didn't have a good answer. Why aren't people demonstrating, speaking up? It's just, it has to happen more to feel the plight of our brothers and sisters that are suffering right now, not too far from here. We'll have a story hopefully within a few days, and we might even see a rough draft of it at the end of this about some of the Christians that have fled to Jordan and Amman. We were there a few weeks ago, and they're doing a story on them. Not only are the Christians suffering, but also the group called Yazidis. And we had the opportunity to go to a refugee camp that many of the Yazidis fled to after ISIS came into their town called Sinjar. They eventually went up to something called Mount Sinjar, and you might have remembered last summer the story of their plight. And so this is their story about the Yazidis.
It looks like a scene out of the Bible, a modern-day exodus.
Tens of thousands made the trek from Mount Sinjar all the way here to the United Nations refugee camp. For some, a 2, 3, even 4-day journey. Most of them came with just the clothes on their back. And out of the multitude, each one has a story.
When ISIS attacked Sinjar, home to most of these Yazidis, Guli Udaida, a name which means God giveth, said it felt like the end of the world.
When they came, they caught some people and kidnapped beautiful girls and took them away. We escaped. The ones that stayed, ISIS killed.
When they got to Mount Sinjar, her son went back for food. ISIS captured him, shot him, took out his eyes and cut off his head. His friend buried him. The mountain had its own horrors. Flus Kadar used this cap from a medicine bottle to keep her children alive.
I gave my children a drop of water every hour. The water was very far away.
When the Yazidis made their escape from Mount Sinjar, this is the route that they took. Mount Sinjar is about 100 miles away, and most of that is simply desert. They finally came to this desert road behind me, crossed the Tigris River, and made their way up the road to the United Nations camp.
It took Kadar 4 days to make the walk. He had arrived just 1 hour before we talked to him.
We are in a desperate situation. We don't have any hope. We don't have any salvation. I am tired and I just want to get some sleep.
These 12-year-old boys, like Tasim, saw things likely to haunt them the rest of their lives. Razin remembers the mountain.
Many kids died on the mountain because there was no water. We escaped from ISIS because they wanted us to convert to Islam or be killed. I was there when ISIS came and shot one girl with a bullet in the head because they told her to convert. She refused, and they killed her.
When you go from a home to a tent within days, how do you deal with the 120-degree heat, knowing that winter is on its way?
We are sleeping on the ground. The rain is coming, and we don't know what we're going to do. We have no future.
Here in the Middle East, the Christians and the Yazidis, they cut us like sheep. There is no mercy for us.
The plight of the Yazidis reminded our translator when he was a refugee from Saddam Hussein in 1991.
It's not easy to explain. You can see, as you see, it's horrible, man.
In this tent city, life goes on. An elderly woman makes tea for her family. Young children play a game out of bottle caps. The UN supplies water. It's a refuge, but not a home. The war-weary faces of these Yazidis bear a horrific past, a precarious present, and an unknown future. Sometimes the ordeal spills over in tears. Many don't want to see Iraq anymore.
We wait for the mercy of God and people like you to be protected from the evil men.
They're also asking the U.S. and the West for help.
My request for all the believers in America and all over the world, and all the church and around the world to pray for these people.
Chris Mitchell, Bajid Kandala Refugee Camp, Northern Iraq.
I think prayer has been a real theme when you talk to many of the persecuted believers around the world. I mean, especially around the Middle East. When we were in Jordan just the other day, you know, one of my questions at the end of our interviews was, what message would you want to share with believers or the world? And they said, pray for us. And so I think that's one of the themes I've heard over and over, whether it's a pastor like him or the believers themselves, is the first of all, they want prayer. And I also, one of the things I wanted to share too, the next story is about the Peshmerga. Now, one of the things that's happening right now is the Peshmerga are the Kurdish military, and they really are the boots on the ground right now. And one thing I think needs to be prayed for in this whole situation is the fact that they could get the kind of weapons, the kind of training that they need to fight ISIS. They're really a bulwark right now against the Kurdish part of Iraq, and many of the Christians, many of the Yazidis have found refuge in those areas, and they really need the assistance. And now there's a lot of geopolitical things going on why they're not getting that. Some of it, I think, is Turkey preventing it. Some of it's the Baghdad government. By law, it has to go through the Baghdad government before it gets to Kurdistan, and sometimes it's just not getting there. But this is a story we did with the Peshmerga on the front lines.
The battleground with ISIS includes small villages like this one next to the border. We joined the Peshmerga working with District Iraqi Police right after a deadly incident. We're south of Kirkuk right now in a small village and just about a half a mile from ISIS forces. A little while ago, two bombs were set off, two policemen died. Now these forces are rounding up suspects and preparing to attack the ISIS forces.
We have information that people from outside this village came to destroy the situation here.
Moments after our interview, they called off the attack, but did take a number of suspects away. We drove out of the village on the way to a strategic Peshmerga checkpoint, most heavily armed like this policeman with his RPG. As we drove through the oil-rich area, you could see some of the refineries in the distance. When we arrived, we found the Peshmerga dug in close to the front lines of ISIS.
This is the end of the road for the Kurdish military. This is their last checkpoint. But if you look down the road here and see that bridge in the distance, that's the first checkpoint for ISIS and the beginning of the region and the area that they control.
Soon, dozens of Peshmerga and Iraqi police strode past the checkpoint. They're headed to the village next door on a critical mission.
What's happening now is that the Peshmerga, the Kurdish military, is going a house-by-house search in this village, which is just beyond their front lines, and they believe people here may be supporting ISIS.
Yes, surely, because down at the bridge, we saw a teenager. They sent him to do something against us, but he hid himself.
But instead of a teenager, the Peshmerga and police uncovered two terrorists, one from Saudi Arabia, the other from Sudan, both on a wanted list. Our guide translates the confrontation.
His name is exists in this list, that he's a terrorist, you know? And he, the officer says, you are wanted by our force. He says, no, I'm only wanted by God.
They arrested them along with a number of other suspects and took them away for questioning. In this ongoing battle, the stakes are high, particularly in Kirkuk.
This is a very strategic region. Just a couple of weeks ago, the 12th Iraqi Division controlled this area. They left and left a vacuum for the Peshmerga, the Kurdish military, to fill. And now they control some of the richest oil fields in the Middle East.
After June 10th, when the Iraqi army collapsed, the Peshmerga stepped in and saved thousands of lives, including many Christians. For example, they protected the village of Bartila with 25,000 Christians. But many on the front lines expect it will get worse.
We expect that they want to fight. They would like to attack and fight against the Peshmerga. So we're expecting a bigger war.
Earlier in the day, back in Erbil, the Peshmerga Secretary General showed us on his map that now they must defend a 1,000-kilometer border with ISIS. That's more than 600 miles. They stand in the gap against this fanatical group and face a daunting challenge. But the Peshmerga say they're ready.
Surely it's dangerous, but the Peshmerga are ready to fight. We are ready to protect the Arab, Christians, Assyrians, and Turkmen. We are the people of Kirkuk and ready to sacrifice our life to the last drop of our blood.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, on the front lines with the Peshmerga.
So I think the Peshmerga really do need our prayers for the what they're doing right now, standing in the line in their defense. They really do feel like they're on the sort of the point of the spear. And if you're wondering what it's like to be about a half a mile from ISIS, I wasn't planning on that. And describe in the book about what it's like to be in some of those places. In fact, what I tried to do in the book, which is available in the back, is try to take the viewer, the reader there. And going to a place like, for example, the first time we went to the refugee camp, when the pastor said, oh, it's about 15 minutes from ISIS, I thought, whoa. It was sort of my I'm not in Kansas anymore moment, if you remember that line from The Wizard of Oz. And sort of going there is coming to a crossroads. And one part of the crossroads is courage, and you certainly want courage. The other part of the crossroads is fear, and you don't want fear to overwhelm you. And the other thing is common sense. You just want to do the right thing and not something foolish. And the other one is prayer. And when we go to places like that, prayer is essential. It's like water for us, spiritual water, that we need people praying. And so a few of those times when I realized that we were not that far from ISIS, I did know that people were praying for us, and they were the ones that got us through. I want to skip one story, David. We'll go to number 8 about churches helping refugees.
Where can you go when you've lost almost everything?
Many of the churches in Erbil literally opened their doors for the many Christian refugees that fled the advance of ISIS. They simply feel that it's the church's calling to provide refuge for families like these.
The Kurdsman Church transformed their building into a true sanctuary.
The building is for the humanity.
Pastor Majid Mohammed opened doors for both Christians and non-Christians.
We wanted to show those people we don't care that they are Christians, Yazidis, Muslims. We don't care about that because they are human beings and they have been fired out, kicked out at their home by ISIS and the terrorist groups. So this is why we wanted to show them that as a Christians we love them and we are very glad to have them here and serve them.
This man led a mini exodus of several families to the Kurdsman Church.
On behalf of all the people right here, Pastor Majid is really showing the love of Jesus.
Across town at the Ankawa AOG Church, families who are now safe talked about the violent ultimatum they faced.
We have been told by ISIS if we don't convert to Islam, either they will kill us or we will have to leave the city.
For most, it wasn't a choice at all.
We prefer to die rather than convert to Islam. God has created us as Christians and we don't want to convert to Islam. The power of God keeps us and strengthens us to remain as Christians.
Most will never return, like this policeman who escaped with his family and 10-day-old baby.
I am already wanted by the Islamic groups over there. And secondly, I am a Christian. As a minority, I am also wanted by ISIS, so we cannot go back there anymore.
Most told us they simply want to leave Iraq.
This is the only way or the only solution for our problem because we cannot go back to our home and we cannot stay here. We want to go out. Even if they provided international protection, we don't want to keep staying here.
Their long-term fate remains one of the major questions in this humanitarian crisis. Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Erbil, Kurdistan.
One redemptive thing that's happening is many of the churches are there helping out and practically for many of these people. The last video is Ken and Andrew White. He's probably, I think, many of you may know him. We did an interview with him. We've done several with him. And I think he's really the voice of the persecuted church here in the Middle East for such a time as this. So go ahead, David.
Over this past week, the army of ISIS swallowed up parts of Iraq like a
David,
darkness.
David, that's number one, I think. Number eight. Do you have an interview there with Ken and Andrew White? Should be the last one. You don't have that one. Okay. I'm sorry, too. Well, let me just share a little bit what Ken and Andrew White has been sharing with me. He really wants this sort of marriage between East and West. He wants the body of Jesus Christ to be connected because they're suffering here in the East, in the Middle East, and he wants there to be some sort of a bridge. And he's trying to do that by his speaking through different media. I hope to do that. And actually what I hope to do through many of these stories is introduce you or whomever's going to see these stories through CBN News or the 700 Club, introduce you to our brothers and sisters that are suffering right now. And to do three things. And first of all, as we talked about, pray. Pray for them. Pray for their strength. Pray for their physical well-being and the needs that they have. Pray that they can be spiritually strong in the midst of, the onslaught of the enemy. And just to help them go through this trial. The two stories that Ken and Andrew White shared with us, first of all, was these four 15-year-old girls who were given a choice to renounce the name of Jesus and become a Muslim or die. And they refused. They refused to forsake and deny the name of Jesus, and they were all beheaded. The other story he told us was a man who called him and said, forget the name of the pastor, they called him in Aramaic. But he called up Andrew White, and he just was crying. And he said, will Jesus forgive me? Because what had happened is that this man had his whole family in front of him. And he said, if you will deny Jesus, then if you don't, we'll kill your family in front of him. Well, his choice is that he said the words, he said the Islamic creed, his family was spared. But what do you do when you have that kind of a choice? I really don't know what I would do. I hope I would make the right choice, but this is the kind of choices that many of our brothers and sisters are facing right now, whether in Syria, whether in Iraq, or different places throughout the Middle East. Egypt, although there has been a change of government, there's still a fair amount of persecution going on, especially in many of the rural places in Egypt. And so the idea is to help introduce them to you so you can pray. The other thing is to give. There's many organizations that are doing practical things throughout the Middle East. CBN International is one. Samaritan's Purse is another. So you can give to help their spiritual well-being. Some of the redemptive parts that are going on right now is the Yazidis. For the first time, perhaps, in centuries, are open to the gospel. I mean, it's a horrific travel to that place, but that's what's happening in some refugee camps right now in Iraq, is that the gospel is being preached. One other thing, and one of the pastors that was our driver and translator, he said, the silver lining in this is that many Muslims are getting so disenchanted with Islam, because this is not the kind of Islam they believe in, the kind of Islam they practice. If you go to the Quran, it's many times, or the history of Muhammad, many times it's the Islam that was practiced by Muhammad. But it's not something they're familiar with. And so many, many Muslims throughout the Islamic world are getting disenchanted. And so that's why it's also one of the redemptive things that are happening right now. And the other thing is to raise your voice, is to help inform the body of Christ around the world, whether it's or Congress in the United States or other parliaments throughout the world, about what's happening to the Christians and other minorities here in the Middle East. And so I hope what we shared today was help inform you, maybe inspire you, educate you what's happening to the body of Jesus here in the Middle East so that we all can make a difference. And so just let me end this in time in prayer. Father, sometimes it's very, very difficult to watch these stories and to hear these accounts of what's happening to our brothers and sisters and the body of Jesus in the Middle East and other minorities that are just suffering horrifically. And Lord, we see the enemy like a rampage going throughout the Middle East. And Lord, so we just want to pray and ask for help for them, physical help, that you would sustain them spiritually and emotionally, that you would provide everything that they have need of. And Lord, I just pray that you would multiply our voice right here to the nations, that they could go forth from here to the nations to help inform the body of Jesus around the world to what's happening to another part of the body. And as your word says, if one member suffers, we all suffer. And Lord, one part of the body right now is suffering horribly. And so we pray that the body would rally around them throughout the world in prayer and what they can give physically and how they can raise their voice. So we bless them, Father. We pray for them. And we just give you the praise for what you're going to do. And Lord, prepare us. I mean, if we face persecution like that, give us strength for the days ahead and prepare our hearts for the days ahead. Things may get darker, like Isaiah said. So we just want our hearts prepared for that in Jesus' name. Amen.